destroyed. Henceforth, we shall not serve sin.
For he that is dead is freed from sin.
Now, we be dead with Christ. We believe that we shall also live with him.
Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him.
For in that he died, he died unto sin once, but he liveth unto God.
Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof.
Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God.
For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace.
What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Ye became servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity, unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness.
For when you were servants of sin, you were free from righteousness.
What fruit had ye then in those things thereof, whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death.
An end, everlasting life.
Everybody, 23.
For the wages of sin is death.
But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
5 minutes past 12. Let's see that we can leave here. The next 45 minutes are an hour we have ministration in the house of God. Thank God for bringing our speaker all the way from Nigeria safely to us. This man of God is, I've been to his church in Lagos. Great work, great ministry. I think I spent a couple of about 4 or 5 days with him in Lagos.
Don't understand the purpose for his life, then abuse becomes inevitable. You will live the life anyhow. You will live it to satisfy yourself or satisfy your family or satisfy your friends. You will not be able to do exactly what God wants you to do. Now, I understand from my Bible that all of us were created, given life by God to fulfill God's purpose, to give God pleasure. To give God pleasure, to pleasure God with our lives, to make God happy, to make God excited. You know, if your life is not making him excited, then there is a problem. That's the reason why so many people are become a burden to the church. They become a problem to the church. Their life is not contributing to the growth of the church or to the growth of the kingdom of God. Rather, it becomes an obstacle, a hindrance. But that is not your case, and that will not be your case in Jesus' mighty name. Now, if you open your Bible with me to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, from verse 11 to 14, you will see there that God made it very clear that he has a plan for each and every one of us. You may have your own ambitions, but God has his own plan. You may have your own dreams and desires, but God has his own plan. Jeremiah, chapter 29, from verse 11 to 14. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and the future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. So he has a plan for you. He has a plan for me. He has a plan for each and every one of us. And if God has got a plan for us, it simply means he wants us to follow. That's why I say you will come and seek me. He wants us to submit to that plan. He wants us to pursue that plan as our own program. He wants us to embrace it with all our heart and yield ourselves to it and say, Lord, if this is your plan, that's what I want for my life. And I found out that when a man is moving in the direction that God wants him to move, when he's pursuing the purpose of God for his life, he gains speed. He gains support. Now, have you ever noticed that if you're swimming in a river that has high current, and if you're swimming in the direction that the river is flowing to, the river gives you a push. When you throw your hand, it pushes you forward. So your speed is accelerated. Your progress is smoother and faster. But when you are swimming in the opposite direction, when you throw your hand, the force of the water will push you back. So you see, you have to use more energy, more strength, and you will struggle. And then at the end of the day, when you check the distance you have covered, you're almost at the same spot. You have not really gained much. And even if you make progress, it is with extra effort. That is what it is like when you are going against the will and the plan of God for your life. That's why I try to be myself. Sometimes it's, oh, you can preach. Why don't you just preach and don't teach? I said, that's just who I am. There's nothing I can do about it. I may prepare to preach, but once I take the microphone and start to speak, I end up teaching. It's inborn. It's something that God put inside of me. It's something that God gave to me when he gave birth to me in Christ Jesus. When I became born again, he planted it in me because that's exactly what he wants me to do. And I remember in those days, my parents said, look, make sure you are not a teacher. Everybody in the house, they don't want anybody to be teachers because both of them were teachers. And they used to say that teachers' reward is in heaven. So life wasn't that easy for them. So they didn't want any of the children to be teachers. But God still gave me a teaching ministry. So what do you do? It's not about training. It's about the gift of God. And there is a reason why you are alive. There is a reason why you are in this country. I know you came here. Maybe your mind was just to have a better life. Your mind was, okay, I want to get an education. I want to change the environment. I'm tired of the country where I come from. I just want to live and I want to enjoy this place. I want something better. I want a system that works. I want a country that things work. And then you came down. But then God, who allowed you to come down here, also had a plan. For him to make a way for you to achieve that dream, that is the reason. Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. I want you to know you don't just live life to please yourself. You don't live life to please family. You don't live life to please friend. You don't live life to please just anybody. You live life to please God. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Our Father, our God in heaven, created all things for his pleasure. For his pleasure. You are not here to pleasure yourself, you are here to pleasure God. You are in existence to please God, not yourself, not man, not your wife, not your husband. But in pleasing God, you please everybody who is living right, who has a heart for God. The only people who may not be pleased are wicked people, people who do not fear God, who do not revere God, who have not, who are not interested in God. If you want to please men, you end up displeasing God. And many of us are living for ourselves. That's why, we do things anyhow, behave anyhow, talk anyhow. We don't take the things of God very serious. Things you can see with the naked eyes, things you cannot see with the naked eyes. All things exist to serve God. You may not see what they do, but they are all serving God. All are created to pleasure God. You too, you are created to pleasure God. But then, in creation, we are created to please God, but also we are redeemed in Christ to please God. Redeemed in Christ to pleasure God with our lives. Redeemed in Christ to live for him, not for yourself. Not for another person. So, by creation, we are created to please God. Created to pleasure God with our lives. By redemption, we are redeemed to please God with our lives. And so you cannot live your life for yourself anymore, but for him. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. And he died for all. That those who live, will no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. You live for Jesus, not for yourself. If you are truly born again, if you have given your life to Jesus, if you died with him, were buried with him, resurrected with him, ascended to heaven with him, and you're seated in him at the right hand side of the Father, that means you are born again, you are a son of God. You don't live for yourself, you live for him. For him, for his glory. So what you say, what you do, must be such that give him glory. The company you keep must be such that give him glory. The service you render must be such that give him glory. Whatever you do in your profession, in your career, you are existing for his glory. So God must be number one in your life. His interest must be number one in your life. His glory must be number one in your life. You must aspire and desire with all your heart, work hard to make sure that everything you do is in accordance with his will. I was studying the book of Ephesians chapter 5 and I found that Apostle Paul was admonishing the church and he was saying to them, don't be foolish. Don't live your life like an unwise person. So I was asking myself, what does he mean? And how can a man live a wise life? He said, identify what the will of the Lord is. So living as a wise person is identifying what the will of the Lord is and do it. What exactly does he want me to do? How does he want me to react to this? How does he want me to behave in this condition? What does he want me to do for him? So if your heart is to bring God glory, and you always desire in every situation and circumstance that you find yourself, wherever you find yourself, that God be glorified through your life, that is living as a wise person. Only a foolish person realizes there is God and never bothers to please him. The Bible says a fool says in his heart there is no God. But a greater fool knows there is God and doesn't bother to please him. So you were created for his pleasure. You were redeemed for his pleasure. You live not for yourself but for the one who died and was raised again. If you read Colossians chapter 3 and you read verse 3 and verse 4, verse 3 says, for you died and your life is now hid with Christ in God. And verse 4 says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, we too will appear with him in glory. So you died to sin, died to the world. The sinful man died, the sinner died, the old man died, buried. Christ, who is your life? He's not in our life. He's not in your life. He is the very life that you live. So it's not your life. So you cannot live it yourself. You live it to please him. You live it the way he wants you to live it. And that's exactly what I want you to understand this morning. So once you understand that by creation you were created for his pleasure, by redemption you were redeemed for his pleasure, then you make up your mind to please him with your life. To make sure that your life counts, that you fulfill the purpose for which he gave you this life. And what is that? To make him known. What is that? To expand his kingdom. What is that? To make sure that he's honored and glorified and people get to meet him through you. So this afternoon, brothers and sisters, I want to challenge you to rise up in your spirit, take your place as a son of God, and do your duty. Let God be glorified. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. It tells us that so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Whatever you do, even in your eating, your drinking, to the glory of God. I want to ask you, for instance, if I come early to church, does that give God glory to God? If I come in the middle of the service, does that give glory to God? If I come when the service is about closing, and then they just say the grace, and I say, praise God, I came to church today, does that give glory to God? If I'm in the house of God and I'm doing nothing, I just only come sit down, like, you know, sit down and then worship, and then after that I walk out, does that really glorify God? But if I am involved in one activity or the other, one department or the other, I am contributing my quota to making sure that the church is filled up, the church is overgrowing. Which one do you think will give glory to God more? Church, answer me. Which one will give glory to God more? When you are committed, right? When you are involved, when you are dedicated, when you are punctual. So you need to be asking yourself this. If all that I do is to give glory to God, how does my lateness bring glory to him? How? Now, many of us rush early to work. We want to be there on time to clock in, right? Even when you are in pain and difficulty, you want to stay put there and make sure you clock in at the right time and you clock out at the right time because you need the money. You don't want to lose your job. But when it comes to God, we take it for granted. It's not supposed to be so. Remember, life is a gift. You didn't create yourself. That's why the Bible says after this life, every man will stand before God in judgment. Why judgment? Because you don't own the life. If you own the life, then you will not account to anybody. For if I'm going to give account, it means I don't own it. So I'm accounting to the one who owns the life. And so if that is the case, I should be careful how I live, how I conduct myself, so that at the end of the day, I'll be able to stand before him justified, stand before him, you know, praised by him and not condemned by him. But I want you to know you are in Christ. God loves you. He's with you. You have his life. But he wants you to do all things to his glory, to his glory. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, whatever you do, whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God, to the glory of God. So the glory of God should be what you should be concentrating your mind on. My life must bring him glory. My service must bring him glory. My worship must bring him glory. My singing must bring him glory. You know, it's not proper. You know, I'm supposed to be here leading worship by, sorry, I'm not scolding anybody. I hope you guys understand. Playing the scriptures. I'm supposed to be joining in the leading of worship or playing the instrument or whatever, and I come in when they're almost done, or I come in halfway, or they are waiting for me, and because they're waiting for me, you know, somebody else has to take my place. I really don't think that is proper. I don't permit that in our own church. Everybody who is supposed to perform their duty on Sunday morning must join in the early morning prayer. Everybody, including myself. If I'm in town, I always want to be the first to be there. So we all pray together and we all get ourselves in spirit. From 7 in the morning, we start till about 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock, the school of the world starts. All the workers should be there if you want to do your duty that day. If you come late, forget to sit down. That's our rule. It's been like that. And it's still like that till tomorrow. So because you cannot come and middle of the service and take over and join when you didn't pray. No, if you come late, you didn't join us in prayer, you didn't prepare yourself together with us, so how do you flow with us? So you sit down. If you want to be part, come early. Let's pray together. And the people do it. So we give some, you know, concessions because of the distance and all that. And sometimes you may wake up late. So if we start 7 o'clock and you don't come between 7 and quarter to 8, at least you should be able to pray with us for 15 minutes. Then that means that day you didn't really want to do your job. And so that's just how it is. Everybody prepares. Everybody comes. Nobody is paid. They all do it with all their heart. And then at the end of the service, the leaders will still wait behind for review class, for other meetings, for other things. Sometimes we leave there 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. They are not on salary. All volunteer. Why are they doing it? They realize that their life is for the glory of God. So if God is so important to them, they want to use everything they have to serve him. I know you say, oh, Pastor, you don't understand. This is America. Huh? No. There's nothing like American Christianity, Nigerian Christianity, African Christianity, European Christianity. Christianity is Christianity. Jesus is Jesus. The word of God is the word of God. The life of God is the same everywhere. And human beings are the same. Let's not make excuses. Let's live for his glory. I love you all. Smile a little bit. Hello, church. Can you smile a little bit? Don't be offended. I'm just telling the absolute truth. You need to wake up. You need to wake up. You need to do more. Think of what he's doing for you. Every day you call upon him, bless me, he blesses you. I'm in trouble, Lord, deliver me, he delivers you. You seek him here, he helps you. You call on him at this time, he answers you. He never abandons you. He's always there for you, sending people to run around you and help you sort out yourselves. I mean, what is it too much for you to do these things for him? Look at Romans chapter 12. Please, can somebody help me project Romans chapter 12 verse 1. I want to show you something. He says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Uses the word reasonable service. You know, in worshiping God, we use our brain, we use our reason, because God didn't create you as a robot. God created you to think. He gave you a brain to think so that in your conclusions, you make your own choice. He wants you to willingly serve. He doesn't force people to do things. You're not doing it for this man. You are doing it for God. Of course, you say, okay, I'm supporting his ministry. That is very correct. But he is not the rewarder. Even when you give a helping hand to a poor person, say, he that gives to the poor is lending to the Lord, and the Lord will pay him back. Everything you do to God, do for somebody, God is the one who pays you back. You give to the man of God, God pays you back. You give to a poor fellow in the street you don't know before, God pays you back. So at the end, ultimately, you are doing it for him. And so our reason, our mind must be used to analyze, to think, what has God done? What is he doing? How important is he? Is he real? Does he really help? Does he answer my prayers? Does he bless me? Does he do anything for me? And if this God is doing so much for you, then the reasonable thing for you to do is to do or present your body as a living sacrifice. In other words, out of your own volition, willingly, joyfully from your heart, having taken into account the mercy of God, how this mercy, this salvation reached you, you consider the life of Jesus, his righteousness. He never sinned. He never did anything wrong. But God laid all our sins on him. You consider the fact that he was only doing good. He went about doing good and healing all them that were oppressed of the devil. Cast out devils. Raised the dead. He made people happy. He made people joyful. He didn't do anything that deserved death. But yet, he was killed for you to have life. Think of that. Now think of the pain. We are in the Easter season, right? A season where we remember the resurrection of Jesus, the death, the burial, the resurrection. Think of the pain. Think of the chastisement that Jesus went through. Think of the I'm sure you must have seen the film, The Passions of the Christ. Think of how they whipped him with that leather whip, with those metal things attached to the tip, so that when he goes around, then they pull it and the back was torn in pieces. Isaiah said, they turned my back into a plowing field. He was bleeding all over. The bruises. Then they made a crown out of thorns and put it on his head and used a bamboo reed to hit it inside. Think about the pain when you have a thorn in your flesh. He was not permitted to remove it. Blood was flowing all over. The whole of his body was bleeding. He was tired. He had not eaten. He had not slept. Remember, the whole of Thursday, he was preaching, making final preparations for that day. He didn't sleep. He was in the garden praying when they came to arrest him. They were beating him, so he has not rested, he had not eaten, he had not slept, he was tired, he was bruised, he was battered, he was whipped, the whole of the body was bleeding. They gave him a crown of thorns to wear. And then at the end of the day, gave him a cross that is heavy enough to carry his own weight, to carry, and to climb the hills to Golgotha. And sometimes they will fall, the cross will fall on him, then they will beat him. Consider that. And then when the real pains began, when they nailed his hands and his feet and lifted him up, and the whole of his weight was hanging on those nails in the palm and the feet. If you were in that position, how would you feel? So Paul is saying, when you take into account how this mercy of God reached you, in your mind you just travel with him through that road, and then you go through the pain with him, and then finally on the cross he died for you to have salvation. And he sent people to you, and some of them you insulted them, you abused them. Many times he came to you, you didn't want to listen. And finally, he got to you, and you said, Jesus, here I am. Now, when you consider all this, so he's asking you, what is the reasonable thing to do? And he's saying that the reasonable thing to do is to do what? Make a presentation of your life. Total surrender of yourself unto him. It calls for reason. So living your life for his glory, it calls for you reasoning, thinking. That's why I'm opening scripture, so you can see it. You can see that there is a reason why you are here. He has done so much for you, and what can I do for him? How can I please him with my life? Surrender. Recognize what he has done. Anything worth doing is worth doing well. He said, whatever the hand findeth to do, say, do it with all thy might. You want to serve in this church, do it with all thy might. You want to sing for him with all thy might. You want to play for him with all thy might. You want to be an usher for him with all thy might. Put in your best. If you don't put in your best in your job, they won't retain you. True or false? So why is it that when we come to serving God, we just do it anyhow? Please don't do it. There is a reason why you are here. How many of you agree? You could have been in another church. You didn't come into this church because the church is big. God brought you here so you can make a difference. So you can contribute your quota. There's a reason. There's a job for you to do. Look around you. You can see that those seats need to be filled up. So you and I have got jobs to do. And we're here together this week, right? Hello, church. We are here together this week, right? We're going to be here on Wednesday. We're going to be here on Friday. And we're going to be here on Sunday again. We have got a job to do. And all of us joining our hands together, we can make it happen. You know people. Your contact list is long. All of us here, we've got them. Friends, family, colleagues in the office. We can invite them. With all your heart. You're not doing it to please any man. You're doing it for your Savior. You are doing it recognizing what he has done, what he is doing, continuously doing for you. And that's why these celebrations are there. The church deemed it fit for us to have this celebration from time to time. We've got Christmas to remind us of our Savior's coming into the world. We've got Easter time to remind us of the fact that he died and he resurrected. And the Lord himself instituted communion to remind us again and again, as often as possible, what he did for us. So there is a need for reminder. Tell your neighbor, I can do better. Tell somebody by your side, I can do better. Now, quickly, let me share with you how to make your life count. Very simple principles that will help you. Number one, surrender your life to Jesus Christ. That's it. Surrender to him. He's your Savior. Let him be your Lord also. Lord means whatever he wants me to do, I do it. Lord means I have no will of my own. Thy will be done. Do you know what sin really is? Some of us will say sin is breaking of the law. But to me, sin is doing your own thing. Going your own way. Doing whatever you want, not his will, but your will. That's why Apostle Paul said, don't live like a fool. Live like a wise man. All we like sheep have gone astray, every man according to his own way. There is a way that seems right to a man. The end of the road is what? Destruction. So when you go your way, that is sin. When you pursue your will, your dream, and not his will, that is sin. When you know what God wants you to do and you're not doing it, that is sin. So I want you to pursue his will. Remember, you were created for his pleasure. It's clear. You were redeemed to live for him, not for yourself. It's clear. We have seen it from the Bible. The life is not yours, but his life. So you're supposed to live that life accurately the way he wants you to live it. So surrender to him. Make him Lord of your life. Let him dictate. Let him direct. Let him inspire you. Seek him. That's why he wants us to always come every day in his presence. Have you noticed that God can do the same miracle using different methods but achieving the same result? Now, let me give you an example. There are four records in the Bible how God divided the sea. The first one, he used the ark of the rod of Moses. And the second time, he used what? He used the ark. He asked a priest to take the ark into to the River Jordan and then build an altar. Take 12 stones and make an altar, raise an altar, and then put the ark on top. And the moment he did that, the water receded. Now, Joshua could have said, oh, Moses used the rod, so let me get my rod. Why does he do that? Because he wants you not to get so used to him that you don't have any need for him anymore. He wants to be part and parcel of your life on a daily basis. He wants you to have fellowship with him regularly. And when it was the turn of Elijah, how did Elijah do it? There was no rod. There was no ark. He took his mantle to smote the water, pam, and the water divided. When it was the turn of Elisha used the same, but then he added prayer. Where then is the God of Elijah? If you're with me, show up. And then he smote the water, and the same thing happened. Watch Jesus. How many times he healed the blind? Did he use the same method? Check his miracles. Take your time. Take a look at it. He does not want you to get so used to him that you don't come to him every day. When he appeared to Joshua before Jericho, Joshua said, are you on our side or on the side of our enemies? He said, I come as the commander of the Lord's army. I'm the commander. You take instructions from me. If you want victory, take instructions. You don't give me instructions, you take instructions. So every day he wants us to come regularly so we can receive instructions, receive direction from him. So I'm challenging you, I'm encouraging you today to receive instructions from the Lord every day. Get involved, get close to God. Surrender so that you will pursue his will, not your will. His will, not your will. His will, not your will. What does he want me to do? How does he want me to serve? What responsibility has he got for me? Surrender, make him the Lord of your life. Let him determine what happens. Number two, I want you to build strong faith in Jesus Christ through daily fellowship with him, studying of the word, worship, and prayers. I know you are busy, but if you really want to make your life count, you need to draw strength every day. daily meditation of the word, daily study, daily prayer, daily fellowship. Please, it's important. Number three, start seeking God's face to identify his original purpose for your life. Why are you here? What exactly does he want you to do in this church? In this country where you are, what exactly has he got for you? How does he want you to serve him? Seek him. Then four, don't waste your life. Do not waste your time pursuing things that God says is not what he wants for you. Focus on what he has for you. And then you will make it. Five, commit to actualizing your purpose. No matter the obstacles that may come your way, commit yourself to actualizing it. I've committed myself to fulfill my purpose for God for me. Whatever he has for me, I'm committed myself to it. I made up my mind I'm not going to be any other thing but what he wants me to be. I'm not going to do any other thing but what he wants me to do. So if you are doing what God created and called you to do, you will definitely be a blessing to someone. The reason why he gave you the gifts he gave you, the reason why he put the knowledge he gave you into you, the reason why he gave you the abilities and the skills and the experience that you have will be fulfilled. All those training that you had, you think God doesn't want to use them? If he doesn't want to use them, he will not allow you to gain them. The knowledge that you have. The understanding that you have. Are you following what I'm saying? The experience that you have gained. If God has no need of them, he will not allow you to go through them. So how then do you bring it into the kingdom of God so that it can become helpful, become useful? That's what you need to find out. You use it to serve him in this church, and God will honor you in Jesus' name. I say God will honor you. You'll be a success at the end of the day. Six, determined to be a blessing and a solution to someone's problem. If you really want to make your life count, determined to be a blessing. Determined to be a solution to someone's problem. Don't be the problem that the person has, but the solution to it. Don't be the problem that your husband has, but the solution to the problem he has. Don't be the problem that your wife has, but the solution to the problem that she has. Don't be the problem that the church has, but the solution to the problem that the church has. Determining your heart to be a solution. Okay, the church is not full. You are there. That's right. You solve that problem. Oh, there's no one to carry out this type of ministry. You are there. You solve that problem. A solution. Not the problem. Please, I want to encourage you, learn to plant seeds of favor in people's life. Learn to plant seeds of favor. Seeds of favor in people's life. Be a helping hand to others. Hear the cry of the poor. Anyone who needs help, be there to help. Someone is sick, be there to help the sick. Is someone hearing what I'm saying? Someone gave back, be there to support. Whatever you can do to add to somebody's life, please do it. You are there to be a blessing. You are blessed in Christ to be a blessing. You are saved to help people. Always remember, every man reaps what he sows. If you sow discord, you will get discord in return. You run another person down, someone will run you down. And when yours is going to come, it's going to be tougher. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together and running over. That's the law. It will come with extra. Someone needs money and you have it, please give. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Someone is discouraged. You can encourage that person. Everybody needs encouragers. Everybody needs motivators in their life. There are times when you are down, you need somebody else to cheer you up. That's why church is there. That's why the brethren are there. That's why fellowship is there. I need encouragement. You need encouragement. Your pastor needs encouragement. The wife needs encouragement. We all need encouragement. Do we agree to that? Do you need encouragement? That's it. Be a blessing. Be a source of hope, a source of encouragement to somebody. Seven, make your life count wherever you may find yourself, please. At the office, make your life count. So that the time you'll be leaving, someone will be crying, no, you must not go. If you enter into any man's service, into any company, organization, they will not want to let you go. Any man who employs you should be thanking his God that you are in his service. But if they are complaining about you, then you have missed the point. Your life is a disaster.
to the kingdom of God.
Because you carry a blessing. You carry grace. You carry the life and the power of God on the inside of you. And anyone who has you should be thanking God. Look, remember what the Bible said about Jacob and Laban? That Laban went to inquire concerning his experience. And they told him, you are progressing because of Jacob. So they advised him and said, whatever you can do to keep this man, do it. That's why he started cheating the man. And he changed his wages 10 times. Instead of giving him Rachel, he gave him Leah. Because the moment this blessed man entered his service, everything changed. He saw dedication, he saw commitment. Joseph went to Egypt, into Potiphar's house as a slave. But this excellent spirit of God in him showed up. He excelled, and they could see the hand of God upon his life. And the Bible recorded that everything committed into his hands, you know, prospered. He made him the head of all the entire estate that he had. The point that the master's wife became interested. You think it's only the handsomeness and the muscles that he saw? No, they saw charisma, they saw gift, they saw excellence, they saw a different person. They've never seen a happy slave in their life. That was the first time they were seeing a slave who's always cheerful, who is a motivator to all. They sent him to prison. Even the prison warder noticed it. He left the prison for him to handle. He was motivating people in his own, even though he was terribly, you know, misjudged. And he's been punished for what he did not do. Yet, he was encouraging others. Planting seeds of favor. Being a blessing. Forgetting yourself and making sure others are happy. That's why you're in the church. What contribution can you make so that this ministry can go forward? Forget about the past. Don't ask questions about yesterday. Amen. Don't ask questions about what happened. You are here now. What can we do to go forward? Yesterday is history. We have today, we have tomorrow. Life moves on. Huh? One marriage ends, will you die because your marriage ended? Life moves on. You lost your job. Are you going to say, no, my life is finished because I lost this job? I don't think I can ever get another job. Then you have closed the case against yourself. You put it behind you and reach out for what is ahead. You can't repeat yesterday, but you can do something about today and tomorrow. This church will grow, and God is going to use you. And one day you're going to look back in a very short time from now, you're going to look back and you discover that everywhere is full. Why? Because everybody embraced it. Everybody opened our hearts. We made up our minds we're going to make it work. And we're doing it with joy, with excitement, knowing that the Lord is the one who is going to reward us. If you take on this mentality, we'll make things happen. So you'll be coming to church, not let me just go and see what is happening. No. You come into church because you are looking excitedly towards what God is going to do. You have prayed that God will do something. Are you expecting God to do something? And every time people come into the presence of God expecting, they always get something. Those who come to church and go empty-handed are those who came without expectation. Every time I come to church, I expect something from God and I get it. But if you come looking forward to nothing, let me just go there because today is Sunday. Sorry for you. You will go the same way. But that shall not be your portion anymore because you know better now. Amen? So let your presence be felt positively. Anywhere you are, let your presence be felt positively, not negatively. Don't be the source of the rumor. Don't be the source of the gossip. Don't be the source of the weakness. No, be the source of the encouragement. Be the source of the motivation. Be the source of what is making the church move forward. Let your presence be felt. You enter any organization, let your presence be felt. Use all the creativity you have, all the ideas you have, all the knowledge you have, all the experience you have. If you contribute, God will give you. You know, Jesus said, the person who has not been faithful in another man's servant, who will give him his own? That's God talking to you. If you are not faithful working for somebody, who is going to give you your own? Let many find salvation in Christ through you. Be a witness for Jesus. Be eyes to the blind. Be ears to those who are deaf. Be hands and feet to those who don't have it. Be a father to the fatherless. In other words, those who can't help themselves, help them. Make sure that you are meeting the needs of the people around you. And God will meet your own needs. That's how to make your life count. I saw a woman in my Bible that her life challenged me. Her name is Dorcas. How many of you know her story? In Acts of the Apostles chapter 9 from verse 36 to 43. This woman, she died. And the church said, no, Imagine that. The woman was, her life was such a blessing. And she's a widow. She was such a blessing. The church rose up and said, no. Heaven will say no. Papa God will say no. This woman must not die. We want her back. Where is Peter? They learned that Peter was not too far away. They sent to Peter, come on. When Peter came, all the women sitting, crying, everyone, she made this dress for me. She did that for me. Everybody has got one testimony. One after the other, they were showing Peter what this woman did, how she was a blessing, how she helped them in time of need, how she did this. They were all crying. Peter couldn't stand it. He put all of them aside. He went inside and knelt down, closed the door, knelt down and prayed to God that these people refuse, oh, you must do something. They reached out to the woman and said, come back to life. And God honored. And the woman came back to life. And celebration began. Why? Because her life was such a blessing, they didn't want to let her go. That's how it's supposed to be. That your life will make so much impact in the church that if for any reason you want to relocate to another city, the church will say, no, please, what is it that we can do to keep you here? If you fall into trouble, any kind of trouble, you see people rallying around because, this cannot happen to brother so-and-so. This cannot happen to sister so-and-so. No. Devil, you are a liar. People will organize prayer. People will do whatever they can because you are a blessing. But if you are the type, anytime they meet you, you always have one complaint or the other about the church. You always have one rotten thing to say or do. Nobody is going to do that for you. Be a blessing. Turn to your neighbor, tell your neighbor, be a blessing. Be a blessing. Matthew 5, 13 to 16 says you are the salt of the earth. Matthew 5, 13 to 16. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Let this church where you worship pray that you will never leave. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because of your level of impact. I want to go back home. I'm retired. They will say, no, you can't retire. Please, we need you here. Why? Because you are a blessing. And if you must go, the kind of send off they will give you, you'll be crying. Why? Because you are a blessing. But do you know that sometimes there are some people that the church will organize secret prayer that God will send them away? I knew a pastor who told me many years ago, he's late now. He said he had to fast and pray that certain people will leave the church so that he can rest. His blood pressure shoot up. This was giving him so much headache. Instead of praying that God should bless them, he was praying, God, take them away. Not that they should die. God should remove them from the church. And when they left the church, he was so happy. He was relieved. His blood pressure came down. But that shall not be your portion in Jesus' name. We want to see you again and again. We want you to be a blessing. We can make it happen. Amen? You see, this group that I'm seeing, how many of you have seen me before here? How many of you know me? Only mama and daddy. There might be some other people. I was here 2010, right? 2010 and, is it 2010 and then 2011 or so? So if you can remember me, that means I don't know you before. Huh? That means God brought you to make a difference. We will do it. Together we will. Tell yourself we will do it. But I don't like this African time thing. Somebody say, God forbid, that shall not be my portion anymore. Say it now. You see? You want to continue. That thing is a problem. It's a stain on us. It's a big stain. I went to a church in Malaysia to preach. Non-Nigerian church. Local church. Service was to start by 8 o'clock. By the time we arrived there, I was wondering, did we come late? Did we miss the time? The church was full. The first thing they do in this service is to make announcements. Here we wait towards the end to make announcements because we're waiting for people to come. They made announcement, and I observed that after 15 minutes that the service started, nobody walked in again. Church was full to the brim before they started. It was then I hated African time thing. In fact, the thing became so real. I was so wounded in me. I just wish that I could have people like that. Even though in our church we start service on the dot, you will see some when you are about to close the meeting, they will be walking in. Say, God of heaven. This thing is a problem. You have an appointment with an African, they will keep you there waiting. I'm coming. I'm almost there. I'm almost there. 30 minutes later, I'm almost there. 1 hour later, I'm almost there. Where are you? I'm almost there. I'm almost there. The person who's talking to you has not left his house. It's evil. We need to defeat it. Look at Abraham. When God told him to appear before him and present Isaac, the Bible says very early in the morning, before it was daybreak, the man rose to meet appointment. You have an appointment with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you are dragging your feet. Not with man, with God, your maker, the one who gives you life, who just like that, everything is taken away from you. I'm not trying to paint a picture of a God who will do that to you, but I'm just telling you how powerful he is, how glorious he is. That same God, you keep him waiting. To me, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. But if you are in need now, you call upon God and God delays for 5 minutes, you will complain. I've been praying to you, didn't you answer me? Wear a smiling face so that when another person sees you, he too will become joyful. Oh no. You know, in the Bible says that the joy that is in your heart, that shows in your face, the brightness of your face can spark up joy in another man's face. You know, but every time you look, you know, as if you are mourning somebody, there's no encouragement to come to your church. But if each time I see you smiling, I see you brightening up, you know, always make, you know, looking happy and joyful. One day I will ask you, what's the secret? You're always happy. Then you say, Jesus, I would like to follow you to your church. So be joyful. Always be thankful. The Bible says in everything, give thanks to the Lord, that is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us. See God walking through all situations and never grumble against God, please. Never grumble against God. If you want to make your life count, never grumble against God. Romans chapter 8 verse 28 tells us that in all things, God is working for our good. In all things, good or bad, no matter how difficult, how complicated or how tough it may be, God is working for your good. If it's not going to bring good to you, God won't let it happen to you. So don't grumble against God. Don't grumble against the church. Don't grumble against your family. Keep looking ahead with great expectation of faith. Expect the best to happen to you all the time. Don't expect the worst. Expect the church to grow. Expect the work that you're doing to bear fruit. When you are singing, expect the glory of God to come down. When you are playing, expect that whatever you're doing is going to contribute to the success of the service for that day. Expect the best. Proverbs 4:25, as I round up, say, let thy eyes look right on, and let thy eyelids look straight before thee. Don't turn to the left, don't turn to the right. Don't let anybody distract you. Like Pastor said, the D, right? When he was talking about ABC, the distraction. Don't let anything distract you. Stay focused. Psalm 34, verse 5. There's those who look to him are radiant, and their faces are never covered with shame. As you walk for the Lord and live for the Lord, your faces will never be covered with shame. Amen? Amen. Tell your neighbor, make your life count. Say it again to somebody, make your life count. This church needs you. Heaven needs you. God is counting on you. He wants you to be his eyes, his ears, his mouth, his hands, his legs. We walk together and we'll make it work. Like the human body, different parts of the body all doing different things, but all work together as a team. Let's work together and God will be glorified in our midst. Rise to your feet, I'd like to pray for you. I love you. Are you blessed? I didn't hear you. Are you blessed? Yes. Will you be here on Wednesday? Yes. Only a few people answered me. Will you be here on Wednesday? Yes. And then on Friday? Yes. And then on Sunday? Yes.
God is good. Look, look, let me tell you something. It's so sweet to follow Jesus. He's real. He is real. If he's not real, I won't be doing this thing that I'm doing. Leaving my family, running around different places, telling them about Jesus. He's real. You will enjoy him. He will bless you for your service. He will bless you for your service. Hold somebody's hand. I want you to pray for that person that you're holding his hand. Please, find somebody and join hands with somebody, please.